Your doctor may have told you that you have a thyroid issue, and so you asked for the blood test results, but now you're not sure what to think. Or you suspected that you have a thyroid issue and ordered blood tests yourself privately, and looking over the results, you are kind of lost with the interpretation. So, shall we clarify the TSHs, the T3s, and the T4s? Hello lovelies, and welcome to another one of my videos in which we'll be talking about what your blood test results for your thyroid actually mean. We don't have time for chit chat, so let's jump right in. The most common for practitioners is to order a blood test for TSH, and we'll get into that a little bit later on. And if that test is out of whack, perhaps they will also order T4 or antibodies. It is less common for T3 to be ordered or T3 reuptake, but these things are more common with holistic practitioners when they're ordering a full thyroid panel. Also, if you have ordered blood test results privately, you most likely have ordered the full panel. You will have TSH, antibodies, T4, free and total, T3, free and total, and T3 uptake. To understand what they mean, we need to look into where all these things are produced in your body and how they relate to your thyroid. So first here, we've got the hypothalamus. This is a gland in your brain. This is kind of the bossy gland. It's all about monitoring stress and regulating stress. When it comes to the thyroid, it will produce TRH, thyroid releasing hormone, which is a message to the anterior pituitary gland, which is also in your head, that we also know for producing LH and FSH. LH and FSH are the hormones that mature an egg in the ovaries and release it. But the anterior pituitary gland also produces TSH under the influence of the TRH. And TSH is the thyroid stimulating hormone that directly stimulates the thyroid. The thyroid then in its turn produces the hormone T4 and a little bit of T3. T4 is the kind of long-term thyroid hormone, and the T3 is what we're able to use right away. T4 needs to be converted into T3, and that is what the liver does mostly. Some of the work is also done in the gut. By the way, if you have been prescribed levothyroxine, this is a synthetic form of T4. So you see that this still needs to be converted into T3 to be used by your body. So if you've been taking the levothyroxine but you don't feel any better at all, this may suggest that you have more of an issue with your liver or with your gut because your body is having difficulty translating the T4 into the T3. There could also be another reason, and that is that you're having issues with taking up iron from your diet, which is the case for many people that have a hypothyroid issue. The way you can detect it is by doing blood work for ferritin. There was a small study done that women that were taking levothyroxine and were able to raise their ferritin to 100 felt way better than the ones that were only taking the levothyroxine. All right, back to this little picture. You may see that I haven't mentioned antibodies yet. We'll look into those later. But basically what those do is they attack the thyroid. So that is happening right here in the process. And you can see that if the thyroid is being attacked, that it will impair its function and it will be harder for both T4 and T3 to be produced. In a healthy situation, if your body detects enough of the T3 and T4, it will tell the hypothalamus to reduce the TRH, and also tell the anterior pituitary gland to reduce TSH. And the reverse is true as well. If there's too little of the T3 and T4, hypothalamus and anterior pituitary gland are kicked and they will increase the TRH and TSH to stimulate the thyroid. Now you see why it is an issue to only be looking at TSH, because TSH doesn't really say something about the thyroid, it says something about the anterior pituitary gland. And yes, of course, if here the thyroid is not producing enough of the thyroid hormones, it will communicate that to the hypothalamus and the anterior pituitary gland to crank up the TSH. If you are looking at this picture, you can see that there could be an issue with the anterior pituitary gland, an imbalance, and I often see that that's the case for women that have used the pill. Make sure to check out the video linked up in the cards and in the description. There could be an issue with the hypothalamus. There could be an imbalance there, which is often the case when there is stress. There could be an issue with the T4 to T3 conversion. that this could be due to poor gut health, and especially in cases where you have IBS or you have candida overgrowth or you have used antibiotics a lot. But this can also be due to stress. It can be due to starvation, for example, in people that are anorexic. But it can also even be due to steroids, which is not an uncommon thing to be given or taken. It could be because your liver isn't functioning very well, as I said, and my experience, this often has to do with heavy metals. And it could even be due to low progesterone levels, which is often the case with women that have issues trying to conceive. Then it's also possible that the thyroid doesn't have enough iodine in the diet or to use in order to produce thyroid hormones. Or, of course, there could be a thyroid issue. So how do you know what's going on? Obviously, checking TSH is not a bad spot to start. However, there is a lot of discussion on the ranges that are being used to tell you if you are hypothyroid, for example. Because a lot of practitioners will say that anything under 4.5 is absolutely fine. However, if you have a TSH under 0.5, then chances are you will have hyper symptoms. Also, there is new research that tells us that people that have a TSH between 2.5 and 4.5 are actually more at risk of having a miscarriage in their first trimester. There are even practitioners that say that your TSH should be more around 2, even around 1. Well, I'm not 100% sure about that. I have to say I would need to do more research on that. But I do agree that you would like to get it a little bit lower if you are having issues with your thyroid hormones, because you can't just look at the TSH. This is also because when it comes to the TSH ranges, it is actually depending on your sex, your race, your age, on what an appropriate TSH is. So it is a good first indicator, and it tells you something about your anterior pituitary gland as well, but you will need to look further at the thyroid hormones themselves. It's good to mention that it's also possible that some people feel quite good when they have higher TSH levels, and some feel better with lower. You really need to cross-check it with your symptoms. Also, a lot of labs and a lot of practitioners will hold different ranges as it is. So I am going to put up a couple of ranges for the thyroid hormones and for the TSH on the coordinating article on my website that you can have a look at. I will link that in the description down below, of course, for you. But just remember, they are ranges that are common in North America and in Europe, but they're ranges. That's what you need to remember. So we talked a little bit about the TSH, and now let's talk about T4 and T3, because those are the hormones that are produced by the thyroid, and they say something about how the thyroid is functioning, right? Both the T4 and T3 have huge ranges as it is. So you see that there is a lot of variability, and somebody with a low ranges may actually feel fine, and somebody with mid ranges may feel not great. A lot of holistic practitioners will suggest that it is important for both the T3 and T4 numbers to fall in the upper 50th percentile of the range. And for T3, it's even said that optimal would be in the upper 25th percentile. Definitely have a look at my article as well, because this is why I put most of the numbers there. I don't think it's very easy to get those things across. I'd say the point is that there are ranges, but that it really depends on you individually, what your symptoms are like and how you are functioning, if you can say that your thyroid is functioning appropriately. For example, some people may have hypothyroid symptoms while their TSH falls within the range, and also T3 and T4 fall within the range. There are also people that will have a normal TSH, may not get any more investigation done, or get T4 tested, and that's fine, but actually their T3 is an issue. Their T3 may be so high that it's giving them hyperthyroid symptoms. So you see that it's really important to look at the different results and compare them with each other and put them next to your symptom profile. We haven't talked yet about the RT3, which is the reverse T3. I'm not going to go into the science of that. What I do want to tell you is that testing for this is considered controversial. A lot of practitioners won't even look into this at all, but a lot of holistic practitioners will, and they use it as an indication of the stress levels in your body. body. Because if those levels are higher, they can be an indication of stress in your body in the broad sense of the word. So not just emotional stress, but also stress coming from inside your body, for example, because you've got an inflammation going on. So if you have a systemic inflammation, if you have allergies, if you have a strong autoimmune response, if you have adrenal stress, this could make your reverse T3 higher as well. I wouldn't necessarily have this test ordered because I can see from somebody's case if there is stress going on, and it wouldn't change my recommendations. Also, if you want to look at stress levels and the stress profile during the day, you're going to want to look preferably at cortisol and DHEA in saliva. That is a topic for a different video, but I just wanted to mention that those are probably the tests that I would look for if you want to look at whether you have high stress levels in your body and it's affecting you hormonally. But if you've got the RT3 on your panel anyway, it still gives you some information. Then we've got antibodies. So any kind of antibody suggests that your thyroid is under attack. So that means that your immune system is attacking the thyroid. There's some common thought that not everybody that has antibodies will develop diseases like Hashimoto's and Graves' disease. But honestly, I think if there are antibodies, it's a matter of time because it means that the body is attacking the thyroid. And if you're not able to get the autoimmune response under control, over time, it will affect the thyroid and as a result, make you hypothyroid as with Hashimoto's or hyperthyroid as with Graves' disease. If your TPO and your TG's antibodies are elevated, that is usually most indicative for Hashimoto's. So if you also have a higher TSH and low T3, T4, that suggests that you've already become hypothyroid because of the Hashimoto's. But in theory, it's also possible for your TSH and your thyroid hormones to still be fine, but for you to have antibodies. Now, if that's the case, that's an important sign to you that you need to be working on your autoimmune response because, as I said, likely over time, it's going to affect the functioning of your thyroid in the long run. With Graves' disease, it is also possible to have elevated TPO and TG antibodies, but it is more common to have raised TSI, TRAB, or TB2 levels. If you want to know more about those acronyms, again, have a look at the article. In any case, whether you've got lower range numbers, higher range numbers, you always need to cross-check it with your symptoms. If you want to know about the symptoms that are related to a hypothyroid, so underfunction or hyper, which is overfunction, make sure to look at that article that I've already mentioned a couple of times. Definitely not in every case medication is needed, and even if medication is needed for a short period of time, it is possible for you to improve your immune response over time and the functioning of your thyroid. If you want to know how you can naturally improve the function of your thyroid, make sure to check out the video on the screen right now. And in the meantime, see you in the next video. Bye!